Saw a bumper sticker today, or a license plate holder might have been, said, "This is the earliest I've ever been late." and it actually helped me, because I was praying all day for spiritual help. And I say, "Why isn't it arrived? Why isn't it arrived?" And it was as if to say, "Don't worry, I'm not going to be as late as before." Why is spiritual help, why is the help, the grace of God, why is it ever late? Because time worshiping, of course, we're this whole world is just a projection based on time worshiping. The entire world and universe, actually, that we are seeing, that we think we're experiencing, is a projection, is an expression through projection of time worshiping. That's it. Now, there's another realm, which is an expression of time honoring. We call it the death-free realm. And we, those who have transitioned from time worshiping to time honoring, they have the freedom to dwell in the death-free realm. They can also dwell here if they want to. They have that freedom also. It's not like you have to dwell in the death-free realm. You have choice. You have freedom. You say, "Yeah, I like this better." We have freedom to do so. Whereas time worshipers, they are, well, let me not jump into that, and not too quickly, because what's important is time honoring. When we go from time worshiping to time worshiping is trying to make time real, okay? Time honoring realizes that time is just a silly whim. But it's honoring the silly whim because it's an idea of ours, you see. We honor the idea because it's an idea of ours, but we also recognize it's a completely silly whim. Time doesn't exist. It never can. So the death-free realms come from honoring time, and the death realms come from worshiping time. Very simple. So all we're doing here is we're making it a transition from time worshiping to time honoring. And ultimately, we'll have the freedom. Now, in time honoring, those who are honoring time, they're free to appear wherever they want to appear. They can appear in this world, and then they can disappear if they want to. So that's why the great adepts can appear anywhere they want, actually. And they don't need to take birth at all, ultimately, to appear here. Absolutely not. Sometimes they do. They choose to help us out. But they don't have to. They're free not to also. And they can have an appearance, and when they want to disappear, just disappear. Very simple, actually. We don't understand how time worshiping, how much it, the bondage is. It's insidious. It's way beyond what we imagine, how terrible it is. There's no freedom at all. We believe that making real, then, well, that will result in our freedom. From what? From reality. You know, freedom from something. Freedom is not freedom from something. It's just absolute freedom. Okay, freedom is not freedom from something. It's absolute freedom, ultimately. So time honoring is an intermediate step, but it broadens our freedom without dropping yet the idea of the silly whim. But we see it as a silly whim. Time worshiping does not see it as a silly whim. It sees it as the profound truth that we're evolving consciousness. We got to get, you know, we're getting there. We're getting there. That's time worshiping. So, this is the earliest I've ever been late. Yeah. And I'm getting also indications. I went to a store. There was supposed to be something there, but they hadn't called us. So I said, "You know what? I'm going to go there anyway and just see what happens." So I got there. The guy wasn't there. I'm ready to leave. Suddenly, he's there at the front door. I said, "Oh my gosh, this is great." I said, "Hey, do you have their stuff?" And he goes, "Let me go check." He goes and checks, says, "No, it's not here." And I say, "Oh, wow, terrible. Shoot, I thought I maybe got lucky." And then he says, "Hey, wait a minute. What's that truck right out there?" I says, "Oh my gosh, the truck just arrived." And so I said, "Wow, this is really fortunate." And then we went out, and then the truck driver said, "Yeah, we got all these pallets. It's full, but it's on the other side. It's going to take a long time to unload, blah, blah, blah." And then I said, "What about the stuff that he needs? Do you think that might be easy to get?" He goes, "Oh, actually it is. It's just, you can just pull it right out. That's easy to get." So they just pulled it right out of the truck, and poof, I had it. And I said, "Wow, isn't that amazing?" I showed up, and just, you know, did before I left, just in time, everything worked out perfectly. It helped my day out, because I've had a terrible day, actually, and a terrible night last night. Terrible problems in my life, which is great, because it just makes you dislike time worshiping all the more, you know. The worse that your life becomes, you can say, oh, thank you, God, this is wonderful. Because that really drives you to I made so much progress today. I just said, heck with it, let's just go for it. You know, I can't wait any longer. Now, nothing happened, but the intention was put out, was there, and what happened? I established a new norm. This is what the path is all about, establishing a new norm. Now, there are those who try to avoid this by becoming pundits. And this is not the spiritual path. The spiritual path is to press yourself every day to establish a new norm. So you should be struggling with that. I mean, it's a struggle to establish a new norm. It's difficult. So every day for me is difficult, quite difficult. Today was extraordinarily difficult. Now, I had this experience Sunday of this Camaro passing me at 120, 125, who knows, 130. I mean, it was going so fast. And I got sort of irate because I think, well, I'm supposed to get irate, but it didn't hit me. You know, it was just kind of like startling, very startling. And I thought, well, I'm supposed to be irate. Someone's driving so fast. How dare they? But then another part of me said, well, maybe this is significant. Maybe they're supposed to tell me something. Maybe it was foreshadowing that I'm going to go really, really fast, suddenly go really, really fast. Well, that seems to be happening right now. I'm being pressured to go extremely fast for a brief burst. Okay, so maybe it was that. And it is the personality is very upset. I mean, I'm very much, it seems almost unbearable, which maybe that was the dream of the bear. It seems very unbearable today. And I've been trying to say, I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. But the personality is just in an uproar. Everything's in an uproar because that's the way things are right here. They're in an uproar. It's crazy. I'm in a horrible situation, actually. Being put in the middle, I mean, it's just, you just could hardly write a script. But that's great because I realize, oh, thank you, thank you, thank you, God. You're really pointing out how hideous time worshiping is. Absolutely. How absolutely hideous it is. So let's go to the death free realm. Let's just go. I'm ready to rock the red carpet. You want to appearance right now, you know, it was just right now. I'm ready right now, right here now. I am ready, whatever. Show me the door and I'm going through it, period. That's it. I'm finished. So I was going super fast today, so that can unnerve, you know, this personality. It can, and it did, but I've survived it so far. It's pretty bad. I didn't lose my cool, but almost, almost really. So if you're struggling, what's the key? Realize you're the wow, you're going real fast, actually. This is what's really happening. You're going really fast. And the person I say, wow, what's going on? Oh, this is horrible. You're saying, hey, it's time to, you know, switch over to honoring time instead of worshiping time. It's just that simple. So again, don't fall into punditis, you know, whatever it is. Challenge yourself to establish a new norm today. And for me, I did it today. It was way further in terms of willingness, you know, way further. A new norm, very much a new norm. Tide is high. And I'm holding on. I go into a store, and I saw it last night. Then I go into a store, and the tide is high by Blondie is playing. The tide is high, and I'm moving on. But it could be the tide is high, and I'm holding on. And I said, "Wow, it's high tide, you know." And so hold on. So I'm going fast. Just hold on here. It's not, you know. So I used all of the techniques and capacity I've practiced and familiar with to maintain my, you know, maintain some equilibrium today, though it was extraordinarily difficult. And it's still difficult. It's like, whoa, I said, let the Holy Spirit, you take care of it. Wow. So don't worry about what's the ultimate truth in terms of I've got to establish a new norm every day, closer and closer and closer to your highest willingness. Just push yourself, say, okay, I have more willingness today than ever before, and let me see how far I can go with it. And then, wow, you do as much as you can do, and then you get familiar with it. So it's the new norm. It's the new norm. This is the key to it all. Full stop and, you know, willingness, then full stop in the wow. Get familiar. Familiarity is decisive. Keep establishing a new norm, getting familiar with it. So today I had to practice what I preached, and I am doing so, and it was a very harrowing day. Tremendous amount of prayer and affirmation and push. I was exhausted, just exhausted. I didn't sleep last night. It's horrible. So what's going to come of it? Well, maybe something will come of it quickly, more quickly than we're used to. This is the earliest I've ever been late. Grace would happen to us immediately. Miracles happen immediately if it weren't for our worshiping of time. Immediately. This is the trouble. We're not functioning the way we're supposed to function. In reality, everything is immediate. Here, everything is still immediate, but the results that we're asking for, we interpose intermediate steps towards it, so it makes it seem like there's time taking place and it's being delayed. It's not really being delayed at all. It's that we are giving the illusion of it being delayed by fractional steps. Okay, so we say, okay, well, this little fractional step is what I want, and this little fractional step, this one, and finally you reach what you prayed for, and it's there, and you think, wow, what took it so long? Well, no, it's just that we really didn't fully ask for it. We asked that it seemed to be delayed, so that we can, we're so used to that, that is part of our worshiping of time. We're so used to functioning in that way of giving this illusion that so it's taking time. So there's some process involved that other than our asking for it, you know, our desiring it. There's no process involved other than the functioning of reality. Reality is functioning perfectly. This is what the sages tell us. Reality is functioning perfectly. Always, 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 always. There's nothing wrong whatsoever in the world. Nothing is going wrong at all. It's all functioning perfectly. Reality is functioning perfectly. Now, of course, I'm speaking to those who are on the spiritual path and who then are bound to the discipline of looking at glass half full. You have to do that. Or else you're not on the spiritual path very long. You're going to wash out. That is for sure. You have to believe the Holy Spirit is helping. You have to feel the grace of God is helping. You have to feel, take things in a positive way. This is, okay, let me look at this. How is this? How can this help me? How can this motivate me? You have to look at it that way. Otherwise, again, you're going to end up spinning wheels. We'll all spin wheels if we look at it half glasses half empty. And so those who are not on the path, they say, well, can't look at it that way, that's too difficult, or blah, 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 blah. You know, they critique. This is not the path. We're not critiquing so much. We're practicing. We're using our discipline, our will. It's not easy, but we're motivated. Now, what gets us started on the spiritual path? The Holy Spirit does. It's not really my job or anyone else's job to get anyone started. It's the Holy Spirit gives birth to the spiritual path in each one of us and gradually raises up like a child until we get stronger and stronger and stronger. At some point, you might come across someone who's advocating, you know, say helpful and encouraging, you know, but it's really the Holy Spirit who's in charge of the Holy Spirit, whole entire spiritual path, actually. So somehow we get started. Somehow we get started. And once we get started, then we have to use discipline and wise technique. Glasses half full. Got to. No matter what happens, oh, thank you. You know, thank you, God. How can I look at this to be extremely helpful and manage our success? We're duty-bound to manage our success, which is very difficult. Had a very difficult time today. I mean, don't think that you won't suffer difficulties with this, for sure. It's, wow, you know, I'm going so fast, I can hardly take it. You know, it's too much, almost. It really is almost too much for me. But I say, okay, you know, this is necessary now because the world is going to hell very, very much into time worshiping now, severely into time worshiping. It's so blatantly obvious, you will have a laugh at some point thinking that it was difficult to see. It's, you know, time honoring is being stigmatized and the world is being told to turn away from it entirely and focus entirely on time worshiping. And it's a total cave-in. It's a total collapse, a total cave-in. By the end of July, it will be finished here in terms of the cave-in. And there'll be this sort of spiritualization level of punditism and et cetera. But the real willingness to do the tough work that actually works, that will seem to have evaporated and vanished. It will. This is how it is here. That the world is now a center for training spirit in time worshiping. We don't worry about can we ultimately understand like Ramana Maharshi. What we do is we use the right effort on the path. We use the right effort. Okay, right practice, right effort to keep establishing a new norm. Ultimately, this is what wins out. So, what else can we do? If we try to grasp it, we will just be part of the problem. If we try to mentally grasp it, if we try to be a pundit about it, we'll be part of the problem. So, we just humbly keep working at this full walking together in the wow, establishing a new norm every day, glasses half full, and managing our success on the path. And all of this is plenty difficult, you know, very much so. The speed today was breathtaking. I got irritated by it. I said, this is too fast, too fast. What's going on? I said, well, it's really the fast, but what can I do? I'm getting pressured. So the world, all these troubles I have are just pressuring me to go faster. So, it's grace. That's all it is. So when you're on the path, everything is grace. You realize everything is grace, no matter how tough it seems. It's pressuring you to go faster, to work at it more diligently, to be more focused, and, you know, to overcome the continuity fear, to evaporate it. And so we're duty bound to do that. This is the path. So you just have to take up the cross, as Jesus says, take up your cross and have to carry it. Carry your cross. It is difficult. What was crucified on the cross? The idea that there is such a thing as a body. And there really isn't. There really is not. It's a pretense. All this is a pretense based on, like an imaginary play designed for the purpose of time worshiping. Trying to make time real, idolizing time and trying to make it real. That's it. So Jesus knew this is all just a dream, entirely a dream. All our imagination has no value whatsoever. So he just, this whole thing was symbolized to us in an external way, supposedly, and we'll no reason to say it wasn't really. Is externalizing an internal process, actually, because at that point everyone was so externalized, it's so heavy in the time worshiping, they insisted that it be done this way. And so Jesus made a deal and said, okay, I'll do it this way, I'll externalize, but it's really an internal process. We don't have to be externally crucified or anything like that. Internally we call all our projections home and realize that none of them are true. I mean, they're just, none of them have a separate will, a separate self, a separate anything. They're 100% just mental projections. And they're not needed at all for our functioning. Not needed at all. Call them home. Say, sit down and be quiet. And they will. They will. We're the only authority there is over our experiencing. There's no other authority. So, right now, the problem is that some of us may be going so fast that it's difficult because we're under pressure to go really fast. Okay, so this is how I'm just here to encourage and help point out what's going on, because I experienced it, you know, brutally today. Really, I mean, that's a challenge. Really, really, really a challenge. And I thought, hey, my whole spiritual path is crumbling. You know, it's all been ineffective. No, not really, because I still got it together, right? It was just going super fast, like a burst, like an all-out burst. And then I get the response was, this is the earliest I've ever been late, meaning it's going to come very soon, a lot sooner than normal, you know? The delay is less. Hopefully the delay is less. Because I'm saying now, I'm ready right now. I walked the door right here, right now. I'm ready to jump ship from time worshiping to time honoring. I'm ready. I'm going to jump ship right now. I'm willing to do it. And I've really felt it, honestly, all day. I was just saying, affirming that I am ready. I have to jump ship. I will jump ship. I can jump ship. I will jump ship. I've already jumped ship. This is one of the affirmations I made. The ship is sinking. Okay. We're sinking into time worshiping. You got to abandon this ship. You got to jump ship. Get in the lifeboats. The Titanic is sinking. There's zero question about this. It is sinking. And we're not going to have time to detail it all. You know, the ship is sinking. So get in the lifeboats. You jump ship. The ship of time worshiping, which the Titanic represented. Jump ship. It's about ready to hit an iceberg. If it hasn't already, actually. And of course, time worshiping has all sorts of levels of sophistication and stuff. So there's all sorts of spiritual, so-called spiritual levels of time worshiping. Of course there is. And the rhetoric can seem very high and all this kind of stuff, but it's time worshiping, you know? That's all it is. Jesus knows this. He says many, many very bitter idols have been made of him and what he had to say to us. It's true. It's true. That's what time worshiping does. It takes whatever that we provide as truth and twists it and distorts it into time worshiping, plain and simple. Continuity fear is too severe for them, you know, so they're still caught up in that. But the trouble with this planet right now is it's being turned into a center of time worshiping. A training ground for it. One of the central, you know, very important satellites, training center, very important training center for it. So they don't want any real truth here at all. That's taboo here. And there, of course, the specious reason is that they think that if they make time real, then reality ceases to exist, and continuity fear then vanishes because there's nothing that we need to go back to or awaken from. We stay in the dream forever. This is their plan. Very impossible plan. Folly. Absolute folly. But we love the idea. Okay, we love all our ideas. So we love the idea of being whimsical. But we realize it's completely silly, you know, absurd. That's all. That's what honoring time is. We realize it's an absurd idea just to laugh at, but it's also our idea, so we're honoring that, really. All right, so we don't get rid of, we don't dump the idea, silly idea of time. We just recognize it has no extension whatsoever. It's completely silly. It's still born, and we just honor it, and we can be in the death-free realm. We can appear where we want to appear. We can appear here and not appear here. You know, ultimately, in the death-free realm, you realize your freedom is, you could choose. You could, it's okay. That's part of the honoring, but we're certainly not at all bound by, you know, time worshiping, saying that's all there is, you know, which is what they try to do. Say there is no other option. That's all there is. They want to completely eliminate the option of honoring time. This is what their goal is, completely eliminate it. And they are doing their utmost on this planet to do so. Their utmost. Many people are helping them. They don't even realize that they're helping out. They think they're being spiritual. No, they're helping out this whole thing by not, you know, intellectualizing it too much, academicizing it too much, flowering it up too much. You know, I mean, some is okay of all this, you know, it in moderation, as long as the core of your practice is this intense challenging of yourself every day. Without that intense challenging of yourself every day, there is no path. There is no real path, and you're just going to be part of the problem instead of the solution. Time worshiping. This is true for all of us. I don't mean just you, and you. Me, everyone. Same. So I do challenge myself every day and suffer from it greatly to establish a new norm. And, you know, it's from the, wake up early in the morning, 4 o'clock, 2 o'clock in the morning, whatever, I start practicing right away. They may fall asleep, wake up again, start practicing again, get up in the morning, okay, what were my dreams, what is the challenge, start working on it right away. And today's the day, I said, today's the day that I'm going to establish a new norm, and it's going to be tremendous. And then just basically work on it so much, by the end of the day, I just feel like, wow, I can't do any more today. I'm completely tapped out as far as my will goes today. And then go to bed, and it's that way every single day. has been my whole life. And it's just, this is what we have to do. If we don't do this, we're just going to be worshiping time. It's not easy to make the shift from worshiping time to honoring time, because we are so familiar with worshiping time that the familiarity thing just delay. So we allow a little bit of light, you know, but then we delay anymore. We try to, you know, seems very slow. It's very frustrating. Yeah, I'm trying to speed things up right now, so maybe I have. Maybe I've sped things up, you know, tremendously. And Jesus highlights this. He says, your life is not necessarily going to be a bed of roses, you know, not at all. You may have a lot of difficulty, and he said, that's actually good. Some sages understand this, that, you know, well, the great sages understand this, that don't shrink from difficulty and unhappiness and unpleasantness and all the stuff in life. It's motivating us. It's a thorn in the flesh, and under my mind, that suffering removes suffering. That the grace of God actually uses suffering to free us from suffering, in terms, so we don't want to just constantly be catering to the flesh and, oh, well, I feel uncomfortable, therefore, you know, I wish things were better, therefore, let me just junk this or get rid of this. I just make this nice. Just say, wow. This, you know, this is terrible, this situation. So how can I motivate myself? How can I use that to get me to go faster? Famous story of the Tibetan teacher who had his disciple build a stone house and say, oh, it's nice, but I'd rather have it over here. I just realized the view's not so good, so you need to move it. So stone by stone, and moved it, and then said, you know, this is great too, but I think the floods are going to get it. I'm worried about floods, so I can move it again. So I moved it. I said, you know, I kept making excuses like, well, this is great, but there's a problem here, and I think it's better over there. And so the devotee is moving it, and really he says, this is horrible. I hate doing this. So he says, wow, I better wake up here. I better use this as motivation. So he did, and ultimately woke up. Now this is a real stern way. Maybe it's apocryphal. Maybe it's not. But this points out the principle, doesn't it? That whatever's happening in our lives, you say, wow, this time worshiping is just horrible. I can see just how truly awful it is. Oh my God. The very notion of remaining in that is, to me, is just hideous. It's beyond reprehensible. It's just impossible for me. I don't want to stay in this. No way. My God, the paranoia, I mean, the personality, all the trouble, the paranoia, the this and that, I mean, it goes on and on and on and on. The conflicts, the power struggle, it's all a nightmare. It really is. When you have it pointed out to you, you realize this is just a hideous nightmare. A hideous nightmare. And the more we try to adapt ourselves to it, the more it really awful it becomes in a deep sense, really. Wow, it's like leeches on a corpse, you know. I mean, this is what we are. We're just leeches on a corpse. Sucking, you know, dead, stagnant blood on a corpse. You know, this is worse than that, actually. It's an awful mental picture, I know. I mean, it's way worse than that. So we're not supposed to be be happy. We're supposed to challenge to wake up from this, to you know, the liberation that realizes there's nothing at all to be liberated from. The delusion is that there's something to be liberated from. And we're honoring this delusion by this crazy dream. When we realize there's nothing to be liberated from, we don't need this dream anymore. We can have we can honor our folly. But realizing it's folly completely, then we can have a death-free realm. We don't need this realm. We don't need this realm. Not at all. This realm's only for time worshippers. We don't need it. We don't need it. There is a death-free realm. I've been there. I've experienced it. I know it's there. We don't need this one realm at all. This is what, you know, is dawning. Is coming up. Is dawning. It's like, wow. It's only for those who have this compulsion to try to worship time, make it real, which eventually they get so suffering, so terrible, they eventually say, wow, I can't I can't take this anymore. Can I need help? How do I adjust to this? And the Holy Spirit says, well, there's a way to actually get free of it. Oh, really? Wow. How do you do that? Well, you just got to work at it every day. That's it. I mean, the Holy Spirit told me is, look, it's a done deal, but you just have to get used to it and work at it every day. And nothing can stop you. If you do that, if you just work, you're going to be free of this realm. And so that I just said, okay, I'll do it, and just start working. That's the long and the short of it. And you know, just keep, and every day establish a new norm. Okay, now I'm used to this. Okay, now I'm used to this. Okay, now I'm going a little further. I'm used to this. Now I'm used to this. Now I'm familiar with this. Okay, I'm familiar. And every day, a new high water mark of familiarity. So it's really awareness of the tools of the path that end up being successful. Managing success that you have. So you get overwhelmed. It's like, wow. And you just have to say, wow, I just got to keep looking at this in positive light until gradually your good humor returns, you know. But for a while, you get jittery. When you establish a new high water mark, you're jittery. You say, whoa, where am I? What is this? I think I've gone too far. You know, I'm not familiar with this place. You know, I don't familiar looking at things like this. I'm not used to me being so adamant and so full of clarity. Oh, wow, this is too much. You get jittery. So you just have to full stop in the wow and just give it time. Don't go into a negative mode. Don't go negative. Glasses half full. This is all great. Wow. I had to do this today. So wow, I finally realized this is I hit a new high water mark for going fast, and I wasn't used to it. It shook me up. So I just had to finally realize this. The wow is just so strong. I could hardly recognize it. It seemed like a negative state, but it wasn't. It's a wow state. You know, you get the tools, and then you can build a house. We get the tools of the path, and we use them. It's not like you say, "Oh, I got a tool now, and then okay, the house should appear." You know, we got to use the tools to ultimately get the house there, and we use the tools to keep establishing new norms, new high water mark. This is now the new norm. Which requires us to, at some point, don't worry about the ultimate goal. You know, go for it. But ultimately, the wow comes up in such that you just should not think about the ultimate goal. It's just, you just stabilize where you're at. Because you know, pick a big, big step towards it. Now it's time to stabilize it. The new norm. And don't try to get clever and outthink yourself and say, wait a minute. The new norm, I want to have the new norm, there's no norm. And you know, then you go into this, you know, sort of, there's time for that, but not when you're in the wow. Okay, when you're in the wow, have respect for the wow. This is what I'm seeing is trouble in this world, is we don't respect the wow enough because we're in too much of a hurry, thinking, you know, that hey, I don't want to spend too long on the path. I've got to finish it. You know, what can I do? And then we outsmart ourselves. We get too tricky. And we don't respect the wow enough. The wow, if we respect it and full stop in it and stop trying to get tricky about it and just say, wow, I've had enough for right now. That shook me up. And don't pressure ourselves anymore by thinking anything. I just say, look, I'm neither advancing nor retreating, so knock off the thoughts. I don't need them right now. If we do that, this is what really speeds us up. The more we do this, the more we practice full stop in the wow. The next day we realize, wow, I can go a lot faster now. This is what speeds us up. If we try and get tricky and say, well, let me see if I can make one, you know, just get real like clever about it and say, well, the new norm is no norm at all, you know. And so try to push yourself into the total pure abstraction. This causes a backlash. When you're in the wow. Again, we can entertain the notion that the new norm is no norm at all, if it's pure abstraction. and build up a wow from that. But once we reach the wow, then it's time to cool it, you know, and full stop in the wow and be serious about it. Don't let anything intrude into that and pull you out of it. It's very serious. It should go into the cave time. It's cave time. So you gotta know when to, you know when to hold them, know when to fold them, know when to walk away, know when to run. Never count your cards when you're sitting at the table. They're tight enough for counting when the dealing's done. And this is very good advice, actually, spiritual advice. Gotta know when to walk away. Know when to hold them, know when to fold them, know when to walk away, know when to run. Run away from, there's a time when you run away into the wow and say, this is it. I have enough reverberation. It's so intense. Now, as we do it successfully, it cools out. It calms down to a point where we might be able to pick up and say, okay, I feel I can, you know, maybe go for a little bit more. Yeah, absolutely. At some point. That's what we do here. Oftentimes the long videos enable us to do, catch our second wind, third wind, sometimes fourth wind, you know, to go like that. But at some point you have to stop pushing. You know, who is it doing the pushing? Who's asking the question? Who, you know, what happens when that question isn't asked? What is it? You know, at some point you reach a wow, and then it's just like, okay, drop all that stuff, you know, drop the inquiry at that point. But however, whatever style the inquiry is, drop it. And don't drop dropping it, okay? No, just drop it. Say, no, I've even dropped dropping it. No. See, that is someone who is being too clever by half and trying to show off, and don't be a show off on the path. Don't be a show off. This is going to really mess you up. This is really time worshiping, actually. It's interfering with success and being, therefore, it's time worshiping and trying to impress time worshiping. What an awesome time worshiper I am, you know, what an awesome time worshiper. I even treat frivolously the wow. I'm even frivolously, not that. I can take it or leave it, or, you know, well, no, that's that's time worshiping. Now, it is true that at the level of time worshiping, no one really gets it. And no explanation is it. And no teacher is it. And nothing is it. Which is a little unsettling. And so maybe that's what they're, you know, they're looking ahead and they say, oh my gosh, how do I deal with this? But in full stop, we don't want to look ahead. So the trouble comes up when we try to look ahead and we can see deeper and then try to say, well, okay, well, how start strategizing for that. No, that's a taboo in full stop. We don't do that. We just stay right here, right now. You know, it's cold. It's the evening time, sitting here. And I've got this intense spiritual buzz going on, and that's all that's happening. You know, and of course, the time worshippers say, well, we can fake the buzz. We'll just, you know, get high and we'll have a buzz happening too. We'll sit here all night with the buzz too. Well, that's time worshiping. That's what time worshippers do. That does not evaporate the continuity fear between time worshiping and time honoring. It doesn't do any of that. So I was kind of bit alarmed by how fast I was going today and the intensity of it all. I have to. There's crisis. People are acting badly, you know. But this, I say, that's just helping me out. Thank you. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Just really putting the screws to me. And I wouldn't be surprised if a lot of those watching are having the screws put to them too right now, actually. And so just say, thank you, Holy Spirit. This is really causing me to go faster. Yeah. But again, don't just dispense with full stop on the wow. You got to have some control. Boy, the weather is way cooler than normal now here. It's a big weather pattern. The jet stream has dipped down from the Arctic and down to into Southern California, and it's bringing very cool weather. I mean, weather forecast is like just for like mid-60s for the next 10 days, sort of. It's just some more rain, but very cool. And nighttime's also quite cool. Dipping down in the low 40s. I don't know how cold it's going to get. This isn't anything like what we've had the last 4 years. The last 4 years has been like summer pretty much all year round. Just, you know, very balmy and mild in November, December, January. Just, you have days that, you know, it's 85 degrees. So the new, different weather pattern we're experiencing here. And we don't know exactly how that's going to play out. Oh, gosh, it's cold, yeah. This is really something. So there is abstraction. There's great abstraction. And then there's pure abstraction. We're going for you would say great abstraction. We're practicing all of them, but I would say honoring time is great abstraction, but it's not absolute abstraction, pure abstraction, which is beyond anything we can even think of as a goal. We can't even imagine how a goal, you know, so that we're reaching, it would be an absurdity to try and grasp that or anything. And Jesus says that's not the goal that he sets for us, because it's impossible here to be in pure abstraction and remain here. So great abstraction, we might say. So we're practicing abstraction, great abstraction, and sometimes we touch upon pure abstraction also in our practicing. That's fine. That helps us along, and it's fine to acknowledge that. Part of our honoring of time is to acknowledge pure abstraction, is to acknowledge it, but we're not trying to force the issue into it, okay, and say, well, if I do that, I'll be even greater teacher. No. But we do acknowledge it and do practice it a little bit, look at it, glimpse it. But we're going for great abstraction. Neither nor is a way to, one of the ways to practice great abstraction. You know, no definitions. It's neither this nor that. Pure abstraction, the notion of any need to say anything or think anything would never even arise at all. And we're not ready for that because of our familiarity. So we can say, you know, neither nor. I'm not defining it this way, nor am I defining it this way. When I say I'm not defining it, I'm also, and nor am I not defining it. I'm not rejecting a definition, nor am I not rejecting a definition. Or you can play at it like this way. And this helps us get closer to abidance. Which we ultimately, there's nothing directly that can be said about it. it can only be approached through this sort of neither nor approach, practicing abstraction, great abstraction, abstraction, great abstraction, and getting familiar with this, familiar with this, familiar with this, familiar with this. There's no way, as Ramana Maharshi said, the reason we're so troubled is we try to objectify the self, and we're so used to that. But the thing is, he says that the self cannot be objectified. Cannot. It's impossible to objectify the self, and yet we are so used to trying and believing that it can be. This is our trouble. And this is, in a nutshell, it is true. So we have to gradually practice not objectifying the oneself, the abidance, in non-objectification. But we're so afraid to. We can't say, okay, I'm not objectifying. We say, well, I'm both not objectifying and not objectifying. So this enables us to establish a new normal for ourselves without feeling that we're getting too close to the absolute. See, the absolute, or that's what frightens us. And Jesus tells us that the Holy Spirit is not trying to push us into the absolute. Not at all. Because the absolute, even the notion of a self, or any of this we're talking about, doesn't even exist at all, and could never even be considered. There's not even a trace of need to even consider whatsoever. I mean, so it's no way we can comprehend this from where we're, what we're used to at all. So it's too big of a jump. The continuity fear is way too big of a jump. So we are honoring time instead of completely setting down this silly notion. We're honoring it consciously. We say, no, I don't want the absolute. Say, I don't want the absolute. This is very helpful. The absolute won't get upset. The absolute won't say, oh, really? Well, then you can never have the absolute. No, I say, look, I don't want it right now. I neither want it nor do I not want it. And that's all I have to say about the absolute. I neither want it nor do I not want it. And when we practice this way, it's amazing that there's that which within us, it just thanks us so much, is so grateful. All our projections, it's our spirit really that's grateful. Say, thank you. I'm so grateful for this practice. I'm so happy to have this. It's just wonderful. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. And there's this inner accord develops, and the conflict begins to subside within. Very much so. I neither want the absolute nor do I not want it. And this leads to the capacity to both appear and not appear. Both do this and not do this. And both be free to come in this, come, or we're free to come in this world, but free to not come into this world, so to speak. And so this frees us from the rounds of impermanence, of birth, you know, existence, birth and death and life. We're free from it. We're free of it now. Because we can either appear in it or not appear in it. There's no dynamic that is causing us to appear in it whatsoever, other than our own choice. So again and again, the great sages say, there is a step beyond anything that you can even try to imagine, and this is not really the goal. Nanamaya Ma calls it the great bliss. It's just even beyond the high bliss that I'm showing you here. The high bliss, she says, is actually inexpressibly beyond it, and you cannot, don't even think that you can supposed to try to attain that or reach that or realize it or, you know, abide in that. He says, no. Occasionally she went into the great bliss, but the body became inert and like a stone and cold and like completely dead, vacated, and then great trouble bringing her back. Occasionally she went into that, but just showing that you can't remain here functional when you go into the great bliss. So again, we highlight this, so we practice. Look, I neither want the great bliss, nor do I not want it. I neither want a great bliss, nor do I not want it. Become familiar with this stance. And the great bliss completely honors this. Why? Because it also honors our ideas, including the idea of not honoring our ideas. not honoring truth. So we honor the whim of not honoring truth, right? This idea of time is not honoring truth, but we honor that idea. The Absolute knows this, totally supports it. The Holy Spirit comes from the Absolute, and its purpose is to show us how to honor time and free us, therefore, from the worshiping of time. We can't get free of the worshiping of time until we focus on honoring time. It's not possible. If we don't do that, focus on honoring time, then we will think we have to go from worshiping time to the Absolute, which is it's pragmatically impossible. Pragmatically impossible. Jesus says it is pragmatically impossible. He says it is theoretically possible that in some extraordinarily super, super, super duper rare instances. Okay, but he emphasizes just the unbelievably rare possibility of this taking place. And he says this rules it out for purposes of teaching completely. Completely. And in fact, we absolutely practice the opposite of not taking this leap. Okay, of not taking the leap. So absolutely. And I neither want it nor do I not want it. I neither take the leap nor do I not take the leap. I neither want to take the leap nor do I not want to take the leap. And this becomes the last persona that we have, so to speak, the last belief system we have. This becomes our persona, which enables us to be in what we call abidance in the great abstraction, but not pure abstraction, the great abstraction. And we can still function here. We can still function in that, in this. High indifference, as Franklin Merrill Wolfe put it. This is abidance. And he also pointed out that there's something even beyond that, but it's you can't even call it beyond. The Absolute, you know, and so we don't try to reach the Absolute. We try to reach the high indifference, the true abidance in this all feeling of all inclusivity, and yet we're still aware that we're honoring this whimsicality. Not worshiping it though, fully aware. Say, oh, getting used to the fact that it's nothing. You know, we're getting used to the fact that it's nothing. But we're still engaged with getting used to the fact that it's nothing. In the Absolute, there's no possibility of even considering such a notion. You know, no possibility of could even arise of such a notion. So that's not what we're aiming for at all. And this needs to be pointed out again and again and again, because it keeps tripping us up. We think, okay, but how do I reach the Absolute? No, we're not reaching the Absolute. This is something that has not been pointed out appropriately in history. Or if it has, the personality didn't want to engage with the difficulty of the path. So they said, well, I'm lazy, so my only hope is to make the leap, you know. I'm too lazy to do other, and then of course that can never work. And then they devised, you know, a whole spirituality around taking the leap into the Absolute, which can never be done, really. Pragmatically cannot be done. Then they pointed, well, this teacher did it. No teacher did that. No teacher ever did that. And not in my mind, for instance, never identified, had never identified with time at all. Very rare situation. So didn't take any leap at all. Never left the Absolute. In fact, their effort was to try and go into the great abstraction and abide in that. That's what she did. She went from pure abstraction and somehow was able to, for a while, appear here in the great abstraction as bliss here. Great bliss, but not the great, great bliss. You know, the bliss that's the ultimate bliss. No. And that was a great effort on her part, as far as tremendous focus on doing that. It wasn't easy. There was had to be an intention involved in doing that, a grace involved in doing that. But for the rest of us, it's a matter of the other way. We have been engaged in entertaining the notion of time, and therefore developing continuity fear and thinking then the only way to get free is worshiping time. This is an inevitable result of taking up the notion of time, the silly idea, which means basically process. We're not free. And taking that up, you inevitably then develop a continuity fear. And then you inevitably say, "Well, I got to get rid of this. How do I get rid of it?" And then you inevitably say, "Well, I want to do it right now. How do I do it? If I make time real and really believe in it, truly believe in it, then the continuity fear will disappear." And we get caught up in this. This is normal for spirit. This is how it works, because spirit, being spirit, says, "Well, I should build everything I want like that." And so it doesn't understand the continuity fear and the effect it's having. It's insidious. That's why it's often symbolized by the snake, that it sneaks up on you. It's insidious. Continuity fear is very insidious. Our troubles are very insidious. They sneak up on us and they creep into us. And so spirit just says, "Wow, I should be able to do this." So it looks like, for the quick answer, it says, "Oh, wait a minute. All I got to do is just truly believe that time is real, and then poof, gone. Easy fix." And then it doesn't work, but it says, "Well, at least I know how to do it, so I can keep on trying to make time, trying to make time real here and worshiping time. And when it comes, if I need to, get free of this continuity fear, if it gets too bad for me, then I just like that." And so it has this false bravado, false confidence. And at some point, when it says, "Okay, it's time, I've had enough," and then it says, "Okay, now click," and it doesn't happen, and this huge fear, dread arises. It says, "Oh my gosh, this is horrible. What happened? Reality, there's something wrong, something really, truly wrong. I thought I was just joking. I was playing around, but something now, it really has happened. Oh my gosh." And this is, when it starts freaking out, spirit starts freaking out. And then it asks for help, and the Holy Spirit tells it, don't worry. No. It's just continuity fear. Huh? What's that? We don't understand. Well, why should we be able to get rid of it like this? No, it doesn't work that way. Familiarity is the problem. And familiarity can never be solved intellectually, can it? This is the trouble. Spirit keeps trying to solve it instead of practice on it. Familiarity can't be solved. It has to be practiced. We have to move this big boat, turn it around. And spirit really rebels at that. It says, "I shouldn't have to do this." Well, it's the price we pay for entertaining this idea of trying to deceive God and become prime creator. It's just the price we end up paying. And we say, "Well, I'll never do that again. So where's the freedom?" Well, we're free to engage in this idea again if we want, but we'll pay the same price. And spirit says, "Well, that's not fair." Well, maybe it's not fair. We're still free to do it. So we can, we if we want to, we can engage with this idea again, but we'll also experience the insidiousness of continuity fear again and go through the whole, nastiness of it all again. This is not a Leela play of God. This creeps into the time worshipper's lexicon. It is not. This is hell. We're paying a bitter, bitter price for this idea of trying to be greater than God. It's hideous. And what we try to do is try to sanitize it and say, "Oh, no, it's really a lot of fun. This is God's play and we can enjoy it. It's wonderful, blah, blah, blah." This is the attempt to avoid the spiritual path, actually. The difficulty of familiarity. Now, this is a path. We're paying a bitter price. And once we realize and accept it and pay the price, we say, "Wow, I don't think I'm going to choose this idea again. I can, but I think I'm going to say, you know what, this is one idea that I'm going to pass on. and we're free to pass on. See, freedom doesn't mean we have to choose every idea. It means we're free to choose or not choose. So when we don't choose an idea, we're also exercising our freedom. So it's not a loss of freedom to say, no, I'm going to pass on this idea of trying to convince God that I'm not free. I'm going to pass on that idea. That's also freedom. That's also freedom. So sometimes the days are really tough, aren't they? Yeah. Too tough, you think. Well, not really. When the things get tough, the tough get going. And so this video is to help out with that. Because we all have those tough days, and some of us more than others, right? It's, I've had a tough go of it, to be sure. And just say, thank you, God. This is the saying, when God, you know, when grace, when you're really ready to be free, and God gets serious about you, grace gets serious about you, get serious about it, you can end up having a quite difficult life. A lot of suffering, a lot of difficulty. And you use that as motivation to help you go faster and faster and faster. But don't think those that have, you know, a charmed life as far as money and all the nice things in life are being blessed with grace. That's not necessarily true. They may just be avoiding. They're just time worshiping. Say, how can I be a better time worshiper? We're not seeking for suffering. I don't seek for it, you know. Don't go out of your way for it at all. Try to avoid it if you can, but if it finds you, then just, you know, if the lemons, you got lemons, make lemonade. Just become a very good lemonade maker, which I've had to become that way. I've had to become. It's just crazy. I cannot seem to get free of all these bad circumstances. I says, hideous. But, you know, make lemonade, put some sugar in it, make lemonade. Become ever even more adamant. This is it. This is my final. I'm going to time honoring. I'm switching. I'm going to the death-free realm. Again, going to the death-free realm does not preclude our showing up here. It's just we don't have to show up here as through the process of birth. We don't. We could. We can if we choose. We can also choose not to, and just appear like some great sages just appeared. They made up birth forms. So, well, we don't know who their birth parents were, but you know, we think it might be this or that. We're not sure. And well, they just appeared, and then they just disappeared. Piece of cake for them. Absolutely. We're just dreaming this insane dream of the notion of birth and bodies and parents and having to go through, you know, birth and grow up and go through. This is just an insane dream. You know, just completely whimsical dream that we're engaged with. It's not God's dream. Bodies and form, time, space, process, and form is not God's dream. It's our dream, trying to deceive God into thinking that this is God's true creation, and that the true creation of true freedom is not God's creation, is a dream. We're trying to turn the tables on God by this insane dream we're dreaming. That's a fact. God didn't say, hey, I decided I'm going to dream of time, space, process, and form, and suffering, and death, and yeah, that's fun. I just want to experience this. No. God is just the freedom that we are. God doesn't tell us what we have to experience. We're free to experience whatever we want to experience. But certainly, God is not pressuring us to pretend that we're not free to experience that. That contradicts creation. That would be, you know, contradictory to creation. God is inherently encouraging us to experience our freedom of being free to experience everything and anything and not try to say that we're not free. Not try to experience being not free. You know, this is absurd. This is an absurdity. What we're seeing as the universe is an absurdity. Absolute absurdity. And yet we're free, but we honor this absurdity. We honor our idea of being absurd. Okay? But when we honor it, we don't require time, space, and process and form in order for appearances to arise. Appearances can arise directly. See, they can arise directly. at least give the appearance of that. You know, we realize appearancing is just appearancing. And we want some stability with the appearancing at a certain degree. So the death-free realm gives us some stability with the appearancing. But we realize this is just appearancing, that's all. There's no necessity to any of it. And yet we want some stability, some sustaining ability of it. That's why we call it a realm, death-free realm. And that's honoring time, our silly, our absurdity that's it, we're honoring it. So since, if we're going to honor something, we want the form of honoring to be there, you know, the honoring of it, whatever that is, the format. So there's a format to the death-free realm, sure. So it's great abstraction, but it's not pure abstraction. Jesus calls it, it's still perception, Jesus says. It's still illusion, it's still perception, it's still projection, but it's the final one, it's the final one. So we don't have to be experts at time worshiping at all. We don't have to be masters of time worshiping. Not at all. That's not the goal at all. Our goal is to switch over to honoring time instead of worshiping it. That's all. And I get pretty upset. I say, hey, I want it. Just appear. You know, I said today, all the great sages, you don't have to take birth for me. Absolutely do not. If you want to appear, just appear. And if you want to disappear, just disappear. I'm completely fine with that. So, appear right now. Come on. I'm very serious about that. I gave up all notion that any help that has to come to me does not have to go through any of the cycles of time worship, the time worshiping, the dream of time worshiping. They do not have to go through any of the so-called process whatsoever. The appearance can be right here, right now, and the disappearance can be right here, right now. And death, their disappearance does not have to be due to sickness, to death, to going away. They can just vanish. I'm perfectly happy with that. Appearing and vanishing, appearing and vanishing. That's fine. So I'm taking a much more time-honoring attitude now and willingness. You see, I'm getting into the willingness of it. Or if they choose, they can also go through a birth here, the appearance of birth, appearance of parents, etc., etc. Jesus really didn't have any parents. He had the appearance of parents. His parents didn't understand him at all, actually. The idea that there's parents who was supportive and helpful and really understood him is not really true. It's not really true. They didn't understand. But they had some willingness. They were working towards honoring time, you see. They were working towards it. So they had willingness, so to honor time. Absolutely. Some you would think. You would think, but that Jesus, I think it has come out basically that, you know, they said, hey, you know, you're stop trying to constrict me here. I've got some work I got to do, and you don't really understand it. So that's okay. That's okay. But we don't need Jesus to show up having another birth here. Absolutely not. In fact, we're told that he'll show up the same way he left. I mean, he's not going to show up in his return through a birth. He's absolutely not. He's just going to appear. Like he disappeared in the sky. He vanished, essentially. Vanished. Well, how will he return? Out of vanishment into appearancing. That's all. And I say he's already returned. He did, not through birth. Not through birth. No. So we need to probably give up the notion of that we need these teachers to return through birth. Give them the freedom. Give yourself the freedom. Start getting into the whole notion of honoring time where we don't need births anymore. Okay? We don't need births anymore. There's no need for that. This is an attempt to make time real. Births. All birth, bodies, all this is an attempt to make believing in bodies. Now, an appearance can take on the appearance of a body. That doesn't mean it's truly a flesh body, actually. Okay, it can seem to be to those who want to feel a need for it, but it can vanish in an instant, and there's no harm to it whatsoever, right? And it can reappear. So it's not, it's just an appearance. But in worshiping time, we need bodies. We need bodies. Because worshiping time implies form. Absolutely it does. So as long as we're worshiping time, we will be identifying with form one way or the other. Some place or another. We will be identifying with form and the process of form. Okay, and the distance of that form from other forms, the separation through distance, and the time that it takes for stuff to happen to the form. We will be identifying with time, space, process, and form in some way as long as we're time worshiping. And that goes on. As long as we're time worshiping, identification with time, space, and process, and form will be taking place also, which creates fear of our own death. Absolutely, it does. And when will it stop? When we finally decide to make this bridge from time worshiping to time honoring, and actually get familiar with moving our norm towards time honoring. That's how we get free of it. There isn't any other way. Whatever techniques, whatever, we have to establish gradually new norm, and work at it. There's no other way. You can't be lazy at it. You cannot be lazy and succeed. It's not possible. Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment was dealing with the theory of it, okay, but the practice of it is actually step by step, moving a new norm. They tried to speed it up with psychedelics, and it ultimately did not result in their enlightenment. It did not. Ultimately, Thaddeus Gollus later on said, hey, you know, maybe I messed up, you know, it didn't seem to work out. And this is, well, not really. He saw that the theory behind it all, you know. But you lose, if you get too much into theory, you lose sight of the practice, and that's bad. You've got to balance the two. That's why Jesus in A Course in Miracles says, well, here's the theory in the book, and then here's the workbook, here's the practice, and start practicing. And you have to have a balance between theory and practice. But if you're going to do one more than the other, practice most certainly is where it's at, is getting a new norm every day. This is what moves the needle. This is what actually works. There's nothing wrong with these various teachers, really, if you use them properly. I mean, you know, really. If you go to a Neo-Avidan and they say, well, who's asking the question? Well, that's fine. That can be very helpful. If, you know, you use it to get a wow and you move your new norm, you know, and they say, well, who is it that's having the new norm? And you say, wow, that's a new norm, you know, looking at that, that's fine. As long as you realize you're having success, managing your success, and the wow, when it arises, you say full stop in the wow. So sure, but you can use any situation for help. I do that just wherever I go. I try to be aware as to something's helping me. I look at a license plate a lot of times. I see a lot of license plates help me out as I'm driving a lot. And I just see a license plate, and I'll get something very profound from it. A lot of vanity plates here in this area, and I just say, wow, that's really profound. So, I mean, you don't have to go to a Neo-Avidan teacher, Neo-Vedanta, Neo-Avida, or any sort of teacher, but you can also, right? It's what you put into it is what you get out of it. You can just be driving in terrible Silicon Valley traffic and be getting this tremendous spiritual buzz by looking at vanity plates and say, this reminds, oh, that just triggers something for me. Oh, that triggers for something for me. Same, basically. But it's not like, you know, the teachers, Neo-Avidan teachers, are some awful, terrible, you know, they don't, no. They're helping out in their way, too. They're helping out. Just realize that your path, the tools of your path, you still have to use them. And a balance between theory and practice. And the wow is always going to be there. When you move your new norm, there's going to be a wow there. And so then you have to put the brakes on, slow down a bit for a little while. That's all. So those who, you know, go to the teachers, and they say, well, you know, well, I got a lot out of it. It ended up, it wasn't quite what I thought it would be, and maybe the teacher had feet of clay and all that, but I got a lot out of it because they put a lot into it. You know, they realized this is, let me, glasses half full, let me, use this to get a new norm, higher and higher norm, and closer and closer to honoring time, more and more familiar with it. And if they, like I said, you can get it anywhere. If you're really into it, you just see a rock somewhere, and you just a stone or something, just say, wow, that just triggered something for me. A falling leaf this morning, a leaf, the wind was blowing and leaves were falling, and this leaf landed on the hood of my truck. I just said, wow. But again, that's part of, you can do it that way, you can do it, go to teachers, Neil Biden teachers or whatever, and you could that can help you that way. You just, whatever it is that is helpful, do whatever is helpful. Whatever it is that helps you reach a new norm, just do, go for it every day. You just have to be very artful in giving the effort. When you give the effort, there will be a response in some way. So is there some, rightness as far as a teacher or this? And not absolutely, because it depends what you put into it. And one person may not get anything out. Another person will say, wow, this really brought up a lot. And I can very cold out here and damp. So it depends. It depends on what you want your approach, and even not getting anything out of it, you can use that as a wow too. So it really, and onto my mind, say, as you play the instrument, so you hear the song, the music. People ask her, who's right? Who's, who's a great teacher? What's this? As you play the song, so you hear the music. As you play the instrument, like the piano, as you're playing it, that's the song. That's what you're hearing. So, we're not blaming anybody here, causing failure ultimately. There have been some that have been more problematical than others, for sure. A big challenge, for sure. Not too thrilled about it. But, again, that just put us under greater pressure to succeed. So, thank them too. Like, for instance, there have been some pretty roguish teachers, and this helped me just completely stay away from everything they were, all about, which actually helped me go faster. All the, spirituality of it, I just said, forget it. I'm just going to be very focused on the, moving my new norm bit by bit, and not really get into all that side trip stuff, and because, they made caused such a stink, stayed away from it, and that actually helped me. So I thank them. They're very helpful. Just the whole guru thing, the whole trip, the whole spiritual trip, I just stayed away from it. So I don't know if that's what they really intended. I kind of doubt it. But the Holy Spirit, made lemonade out of it. And that's the thing, without the Holy Spirit, we could have a supremely negative view of everything. And in fact, I would. Because the stuff that people seem to do to one another to try and pull us into time worshiping is horrible. So, but the Holy Spirit turns lemons into lemonade. It says, look, you can use this to gain motivation. And I said, oh, thank you. That's very helpful. But if we take the Holy Spirit out of the equation, then we can become very, very negative. No doubt about it. And the glass becomes half empty then. And that's a horrible place to be. So include the Holy Spirit. The only thing that's not negotiable, you might say, is the Holy Spirit. Yeah, that has to be on the table. And this is what the New World Order, this is what this planet is going to leave out, is the Holy Spirit. They're going to say, we don't need that anymore. We got artificial intelligence instead. This is it. This is where we're going. And so for me, that's non-negotiable. The Holy Spirit has to be. It's such a drastically malicious thing to try to leave it out, that this tactic, simply, we have to say, we're gonna, that's off the table. We're not going to discuss that. And the Holy Spirit is what motivates us and gets us to see the glass as half full. Without that, we would fail. We would really have a terrible situation. And they're leaving it out. I mean, I consciously look at all these various situations that I examine, and I say, where's the Holy Spirit in this? Where's the talk about it? And they're leaving it out. Even the Pope, I looked at his visit in the United States. How much did he highlight the Holy Spirit? He pretty much left it out, except for, like, you know, in Mass, the Chalcedonian Creed, and this, that's just punk formality. Okay, but did he bring it to life and say, this is where it's at? No. No, 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 no. Left it out. Left the Holy Spirit out. That is a death blow, you know? When cannot leave the Holy Spirit out. There's one issue that we cannot compromise on. Or not even compromise, but there's one issue that... well, you know what I'm getting at. It has to be included. Cannot negotiate the Holy Spirit. Okay, there's no negotiation on this. The ego wants to negotiate, start out by negotiating this, and we say no negotiation on this, and then it says, well, then I'm not going to negotiate anything, and then immediately takes a hard line and say, well, you know, no, this is just the we're not going to negotiate this. Even if you say, well, then there's no negotiations at all, we're still not going to negotiate the Holy Spirit, because without that, we would only see lemons, actually. And then we would go toward artificial intelligence and the hellish delay that brings up. It's a clever way to seem like to lessen delay, but only materially. You know, it speeds up time, seems to speed up time. But it's not really... That's the short term, that's the myopic view of it. It actually expands it, you know. Actually expands the realm, but by making it seem speeding up, we think, oh, we get stuff faster, we order stuff, you know, and boom, a drone delivers, and we say, wow, we're really speeding up time, you see. But this is worshiping time. So look how wonderful time is. We can make it fast. The Holy Spirit doesn't speed up time. It Jesus puts it, it makes time unnecessary. You sort of leap. Jesus says you leap past delay. You leap past delay, and make the time unnecessary that would have been there. That's not the same as speeding up time. It's different. So we have, on one hand, we have the artificial intelligence, which is so terrible. On the other hand, we have the Holy Spirit. So we cannot negotiate a blend between the two of them. They're fundamentally different. And we need the fullness of the Holy Spirit to help us deal with artificial intelligence. We cannot have a truncated Holy Spirit. We cannot put it on the back burner. It has to be on the front burner for us. That's not negotiable. It's always on the front burner for us on the path. Call it whatever you want. Grace of God is always on the front burner. And this is what the world is leaving out. I can't hold any conversation with anybody where they include the Holy Spirit. And I feel there's enormous total resistance to it. They say, we'll allow, you can talk about anything you want, but you cannot talk about the Holy Spirit. And I say just the opposite. I said, we can talk about whatever you want, but we must include the Holy Spirit. And the ego won't accept this. So, you know. This is the problem here. I have no conversations with anybody that includes the Holy Spirit. Almost nobody. You have to say. Yeah, it's super rare. So this is a difference. When you go to honoring time, you have to talk about the Holy Spirit. You have to understand what its role is and what's going on, the grace of God, how it works, and how salvation is possible. And if you're worshiping time, you're going to try to get rid of the Holy Spirit and replace it. And how are we trying to replace the Holy Spirit? With artificial intelligence. That's how. Plain and simple. And we have these worshipers of time who are very, very clever with artificial intelligence, and they've invaded this planet. They didn't migrate here, they invaded it. Okay, enough of this migration nonsense. It's invasion. And of course they invented this story like, oh yeah, we're refugees, you know, we're fleeing nonsense. Our planet has been destroyed. We're refugees. We're in this terrible war. Will you please take us in? Oh, help us, help us, help us, you know. No, they're invaders. They invaded this planet. And they want to set it up as a core, you know, place for time worshiping. Spreading the gospel of time worshiping throughout the universe. This is their goal. It's their agenda. So nobody in any problem resolution, nobody brings up the Holy Spirit. But if you put the Holy Spirit there, then you find everything changes for the better. But they refuse to do so. Absolutely refuse to do so. This makes it so difficult on me. They expect me to help solve their problems, but they insist on keeping the Holy Spirit out of the situation. That's impossible. Totally impossible. Puts me in an impossible situation. Because the only way to solve our problems is to go to honoring time, which means to leave worshiping time behind. We're not leaving a vacuum, tabula rasa, where there's no familiarity. We're leaving vast familiarity with time worshiping behind. So it requires a very dedicated path of establishing new norms every day. It really does. Now, you aim for that. If you aim for it, you do that. If you slack off a day, well, aim the next day. You know, don't try not to slack, though, because it gets difficult if you start slacking. Just like I didn't run today, tomorrow might be more difficult to get me to run. But I was in such bad mental mental shape. Wow. I said I really got to pull this through somehow today. That's okay. I need another day to rest my legs. I felt terrible today. I actually ate some solid food today, a sandwich, 2 pieces of bread and a piece of cheese, but I'm pretty much a liquid diet. Felt good to eat some solid food. Probably didn't have nearly as many calories as Greek yogurt, though, which is not, it's pretty liquidy. I mean, I don't really call it solid food, but you don't drink it, I mean, but still. It's like, I mean, walnuts and Greek yogurt, that's got like maybe 250, 300 calories. Sandwich, I don't think it has that much at all. Some cheese and some bread, that's not many calories at all there. Some onions, some lettuce, some mayonnaise and mustard. I enjoyed it. I haven't eaten tonight anything. Ah, I made a strawberry smoothie. All strawberries, organic strawberries, 100%. That and some cranberry juice. And that's my dinner, I guess. So, we're likely to be going very fast right now, and you might be suffering from that. Because the effort by time worshippers is very severe. And they're saying, you have all this freedom, you just can't bring the Holy Spirit into the picture. You have all this freedom, but it's only freedom within time worshiping. You can worship time all these different ways. But insidiously, they're substituting artificial intelligence for the Holy Spirit, which is what all these tech companies are doing. You see how they leave religion out, they leave the Holy Spirit out of options. It's just so blatantly obvious. You know, I guess they're thinking that we're all idiots, really. Which is very condescending on their part. They really have this attitude like, well, these people are too stupid, they'll never get it. No, we get it. We really get it. Don't worry, we get it. Edging God out, ego edging God out, bringing artificial intelligence in. They're edging the Holy Spirit out and bringing artificial intelligence in. Say, hey, you know, look at all the freedom you have in worshiping time. So many ways to do it. And things have been done faster, faster, faster. I asked someone what their favorite car was. I asked someone who knows a lot about it, and they said, Chevy. I said, what? Chevy? Yeah, Chevy. He says, great car, Chevys. I said, wow, that's interesting. Very humble, very mundane, right? I mean, and I saw this old car today, very interesting, very old car. I even stopped and got out my vehicle, and it was in the parking lot, and it was all in dilapidated condition. No roof to it, and it was really, you know, wow. But this thing was, and I said, what kind of car is this? I gotta know. And I went and looked the album. It was a Chevy. It was a Chevy. It was an old, old, old Chevy. Gosh, it might have been from the 20s or 30s. I don't know when Chevy started, but yeah, very interesting. But I liked it. You know, I just said, that's really a classic. That's really something classic about that. So just like drive a Chevy, you know, in the spiritual path. Just like drive a Chevy. Just be humble, be lowly, be humble. Keep moving your new norm. And you see, don't rest on your laurels. Don't say, wow, you know, I reached a new high water norm today. You know, I'm very spiritual. No, the next day you get them and say, hey, I've got to make a new norm today. And so that's going to be a struggle for me. So these people, those who don't want to be seen as struggling, you know, this is a problem. I mean, yeah, I walk down sometimes, I walk with my head down, and it's like, how you doing today? I say, well, I don't know, I'm still alive, you know, it's a big struggle. And they say, oh, well, you know, he's, you know, a real sinner struggling with, you know, the stuff. Well, I'm trying to establish a new norm. That could be a very great abstraction, you know, but it's very difficult. So it doesn't mean that I'm some, you know, lost sheep. It means I'm working on some very, very, very intense, great abstraction. But it's struggle. It's struggle for sure. Going real fast. Maybe I'm just going really, really fast, and it's causing me issues. Same with you, right? Same thing. Could be the same thing. So, yeah, I think I've had enough of this cold. Really, it's enough is enough. See, there you go. At some point, you say, okay. Thank you, and just, I hope, take all this to heart, and I hope it's been encouraging, and if you're going fast, that's great, because that you're in sync then with what's going on. We're really in sync, as artificial intelligence is replacing, insidiously replacing the Holy Spirit in our awareness and consciousness, and we are saying no to that. That's not negotiable at all. So we're jumping ship. We're abandoning ship. We're going to honoring time, plain and simple. And we can still appear here. Absolutely. We can keep appearing here. Absolutely. We're free to do so. Right? And ultimately, we'll realize our freedom. We're also free to not appear if we want to. And death doesn't have to be involved in that whatsoever, actually. No. Not in time honoring, okay? So this is all a new high water mark, new high water mark, new high water mark. New normal. Very great, that's it.